Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Rise and go towards the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place." And he rose and went. And there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning seated in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over and join this chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he said, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before its shearers is silent, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." And the eunuch said to Philip, "About whom, I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with this scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. And as they were going along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized?" And he commanded the chariot to stop. And they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself in Azotus, and as he passed through, he preached the gospel to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Father, we do want to thank you for people like Philip and thousands and millions of others who have shared the faith for over 2,000 years. And we thank you, Lord, that we are the recipients of that faith and that gospel. And so we thank you for your faithful servants through the ages. We pray, Lord, that you will help us to be equally faithful, that as we are on mission, as we share the gospel, that you will work through us, that our lives may count for eternity and growing your kingdom. Speak to us and challenge us and teach us again from your word, we pray, for Christ's sake. Amen. As you know, we are spending 8 weeks looking at our DNA through the lens of the book of Acts. Acts, as you know, is Church History 101. This is where it all started. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, tell us about the earthly ministry of Jesus in Palestine 2,000 years ago. The book of Acts is the ongoing heavenly ministry of Jesus as he works through his word, through his spirit, and through his people. So far, we've looked at three of the four principles in our DNA. We've looked at redeemed, we've looked at family, and we've looked at servants. This week and next week, we're going to pick up the word mission as we open up once again the pages of the book of Acts. The passage we have in front of us here is a well-known passage. Let's give you a little bit of background concerning Philip. Philip, we first hear about Philip in chapter 6. So you may want to turn to chapter 6, verse 3, where the church elected seven men to lead and serve in the church in addition to the 12 apostles. And one of those seven was Philip. It's the first time we meet him here in the book of Acts, verse 3. "Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you seven men of good repute, full of the Spirit and wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicolaus, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands on them. So last week we looked at the life of Stephen. Royden took us through the life of Stephen. Royden said we're going to defer the stoning until this week when I'm back. That's supposed to be a joke. So we looked at Stephen in chapter 6 and 7. Chapter 8, we're looking at the life of Philip. And we pick him up again, chapter 8, verse 4. We read there, chapter 8, verse 4, Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. So Philip does mission, he does evangelism amongst the crowds, amongst large groups of people, but he also does evangelism mission with one person, one-to-one. So of course both methods are biblical methods. There's a place for mass evangelism. There's a place for speaking to crowds and sharing the gospel. But there's equally a place for dealing one-to-one, sharing the gospel with friends and with colleagues. Now, let's unpack the passage under four headings, four principles: God's command, God's providence, God's method, and God's message. But first, let me just go down one side road. A young black gentleman said to me some time ago that he's not interested in Jesus because it's a white man's religion. Of course, I tried to persuade him otherwise. In our country, there seems to be something of a kind of a backlash or movement against the West, against Western values, for the African roots that we have. Be that as it may, what is important for us to understand is that Christianity is not Western and it's not a white man's religion. Remember that the roots of Christianity are found in Palestine, modern-day Israel. Palestine was neither Eastern nor Western. If you look at it geographically, it's a kind of a bridge between Europe and Africa and Asia. If Jesus was to walk through the doors there at the back, we probably wouldn't recognize him. He would look like a normal Palestinian man. So if you Google Palestinian men, some of them are gorgeous. But if you Google Palestinian men, you will notice they're not white and Western. No, they are Palestinian. Paul was a Jew, but he wasn't a Jew from Israel. He was a Jew from Tarsus. Tarsus is a big city in Turkey. Presently, they have 3 million people living in Tarsus. So Paul actually was a Turk. So if you Google Turkish men, you will see what Paul looks like. The only continent that Jesus visited, apart from living in Palestine, was Africa. He visited Africa when he was a baby. He was a refugee. And his parents brought him here to escape the persecution he was facing by the king of Israel. Pentecost chapter 2, you remember. Devout Jews from every nation were in Jerusalem. Out of the 15 nations that are mentioned, 3 are from Africa: Egypt, Libya, and Arabia. After Jerusalem, the first church was planted in Jerusalem. That's in Palestine. The second church was planted in Antioch. Antioch is in Syria, and that's where the second church was planted. Just by the way, in the Old Testament, Moses, who's the greatest prophet of the Old Testament, Moses had 2 wives. One of his wives was a Cushite. Cush was where Ethiopia is today. So much for mixed marriages in the days of apartheid. Here in chapter 8, God specially calls Philip to speak to whom? To an Ethiopian eunuch. The word Ethiopia, normally in the Bible, would refer to North Africa in general. 4 of the greatest theologians, church leaders in church history, has been Calvin, Luther, Augustine, and Athanasius. I think, arguably, those are the 4 greatest church leaders, theologians in Christendom. 2 of them were from Africa. Augustine was from Algeria, which is why I support the Algerian soccer team. And Athanasius was from Egypt. So two of the four greatest theologians that we have ever had come from Africa. Listen to these facts. In 2014, there was a milestone in world Christianity when South America passed Europe, that's the whole of UK, including Russia, as the continent with the most Christians, South America. By 2025, it is estimated that Africa will bypass South America, that there will be 700 million Africans who are Christians and 600 million South Americans who are Christians. Also by 2025, they estimate that 80%, listen to this, 80% of all Christians will come from Asia, South America, and Africa. 80%. Hardly a white man's religion. All right, let's dig into our passage. First of all, God's command. Notice in chapter 8, verse 4. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Verse 26, our passage this morning. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Rise and go towards the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place." And he rose and went. Verse 40 in our passage. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he passed through, he preached the gospel to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. God's command has always been that we are to take the gospel to all nations, to all people. Now, there's some of us who sometimes say that I don't think I have the gift of evangelism. Or perhaps there's someone who says that I don't need to share the gospel, I don't need to do evangelism or mission because God is sovereign and he will draw people to himself. One of the greatest missionaries in the 1800s was William Carey, who took the gospel to India. When he was planning his trip, he met with a certain committee, and one of the men in the committee said, "Young man, sit down. When God pleases to convert the heathen, he will do it without your help or mine." End of quote. Well, of course, that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that God is sovereign, that God will draw his elect to himself. But God uses means. He uses us as the agents, the means to share the gospel. So, in fact, the great missionary in the book of Acts is God himself. God is the great missionary God on a mission. So at Pentecost, he pours out his spirit so that the gospel will go to all nations. He calls Peter to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. He calls Stephen to preach the gospel and to die for the gospel. He calls Philip to preach the gospel to an African. Acts 11, verse 18, God has granted even the Gentiles repentance that leads to life. So God still calls us as a church, individually, that through our lives, through our love, through our example, but especially through our words, to share the gospel. Now, I've been a Christian long enough to know that if you want to make a Christian feel guilty, talk about one of two things. Talk about evangelism or talk about prayer. And we all feel guilty because we all feel that we're not doing enough. We all feel like failures, so join the club. There are different ways in which we do evangelism. So there's not one way of doing it. There are different ways. You may want to invite friends or family to come to church. Perhaps you've done that this morning. And perhaps the last minute they sent you an SMS and said they can't make it. I know how often that happens. Perhaps you can invite people to the Easter services. Some people wouldn't normally come to church, but they may come on Easter Sunday or Good Friday. We need to drop hints about our faith. So if people don't know that you're a Christian, you can't stand up and stand on your desk and say, "I'm a Christian." You can't do that, obviously. We need to drop hints. So you need to drop hints in different ways. I mean, there's 100 different ways. Perhaps someone talks about a certain crisis or tragedy that they're having in their family, and you can genuinely say to them, "Do you mind if I pray for that?" Perhaps someone asks you, "How was your weekend?" And you can say, "Well, I went to church yesterday morning. The sermon wasn't that great, but the music was great." What are you doing? You're just dropping a hint to people that you are a believer, that you go to church. Someone mentions that they're struggling with their teenage son. So you say, you know, there's a great book by James Dobson called Bringing Up Boys. Why don't you get it? There's another great book, Bringing Up Girls. So there are different ways in which we drop hints. Someone talks about certain difficulties they're having in their marriage, and you can say in 2 months' time our church is having another course called Five Love Languages. Why don't you come to that? Come with me. I'll be going. So we need to be ready to drop hints. Just little hints. It's just one or two words so that people know that we are Christians. And then we need to be ready, when the occasion demands, to defend the faith. Just like this young man said, he doesn't want to follow Jesus because it's a white man's religion. So I taught him some church history and what the Bible teaches. So we need to be ready for those opportunities where we can answer for our faith. That's why we need to be taught in God's word. Remember that with evangelism, two things. One is that evangelism is more like farming than selling. Farmers scatter seed. Salesmen sell a product. Well, evangelism is about farming. It takes time. It's a journey. My parents, I prayed for them for 20 years. That's how long the journey was before they came to know Christ. But farming, you will till the soil, you'll plant the seed, you'll water the seed, you'll fertilize the seed, you'll prune the seed, you'll harvest the harvest. There's a process. It happens over time. The second thing to know about evangelism is that when someone comes to know Christ, there's actually been a whole chain of events and chain of people who have made that come about. We are very rarely at the point when someone becomes an actual Christian, but we are part of a chain whereby God uses us in little ways and big ways to share the gospel. Let me try and draw that here on the whiteboard to help you understand. All right, here is someone who is a Christian. They've come to know Christ, but actually, so there was someone, perhaps a church, perhaps someone prayed with them, but actually there's been a whole chain of people, a whole chain of events, a whole chain of activity that God in his providence has orchestrated so that that person comes to know Christ. So it may be someone who loved them at a difficult stage in their lives, someone who answered their questions, someone who invited them to come to church, someone who lent them a book, different parts of a chain that brought about the conversion of this man or this woman, this young person, this child. And we are part of that chain. Evangelism isn't just when we see someone come to know Christ. Evangelism isn't when we explain the whole gospel. That very rarely occurs. Very rarely do we have that opportunity. Evangelism is every link in the chain. And every link is important. All of that is part of evangelism. All right, let's see how that is fleshed out in God's providence. We've talked about God's command. Let's have a look at God's providence. And God's providence has very much to do with that chain and every link in the chain. You see, before we invite someone to church, before we get someone to hear the gospel or read a Christian book, God has already been at work. God has been at work behind the scenes. You see, we may be part of this chain. That may be our link. But actually, God's been working long before within the person's life. So here we have this Ethiopian eunuch. He looks after the treasury of Queen Candace, which means he's the minister of finance. He was probably brought up in North Africa. Perhaps he worshipped different idols. And then someone told him about Israel and the God of Israel and monotheism, that there's only one God. So verse 27 we read. Verse 27, and he rose and went, and there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. He had come to Jerusalem to worship. So in some way, someone spoke to him. Someone lent him a book. He learned about this one God, not many gods, but one God, the monotheistic God of Israel. He decides to go up to Jerusalem. Someone gives him a copy of the Old Testament. Perhaps he buys it. He starts reading from the book of Isaiah, which is one of the clearest prophecies about the coming of Jesus. Notice verse 28. As he was returning seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over and join the chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And he said, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. So it's quite remarkable that at just the right moment, Philip is there when the eunuch is reading, of all things, the book of Isaiah, and he's reading chapter 53. And he takes the gap, and he says, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And then he gets this massive opportunity to talk about Jesus. So when we talk about God's providence, we mean God acts in natural ways, not supernatural ways, but natural ways. God is working, God is using the natural events and circumstances and decisions of everyday life to accomplish his purposes. So God was at work in this man's life long before Philip came along. God stirred his heart so that he would seek the God of Israel. Perhaps Queen Candace said to him, the minister of finance, she said, "Minister, you're very tired. I think you're exhausted. You need a break. There's been far too much pressure. Why don't you take a week off?" And so he probably thought to himself, "Well, perhaps this is an opportunity. Let me take a week off. Let me go to Israel. I've always wanted to visit Israel. I love kosher food and matzos. And perhaps I can find out about this God of Israel." He's in Jerusalem. Someone sells him this book. He doesn't know what it is, but it happens to be the Old Testament. And then he starts reading, of all chapters, Isaiah chapter 53. Now, what is interesting is that neither Philip nor the African minister of finance had any idea. They didn't have the faintest idea what was happening behind the scenes, perhaps months, perhaps years before. And yet God in his providence has the right man on the right road at the right time when this non-Christian is reading the right passage and wants someone to explain it. That's the providence of God, working behind the scenes, working through our ordinary decisions, ordinary activities of life. Think of your own conversion. Think of that chain. Perhaps there was a Christian teacher who had a huge impact on your life. Perhaps there was a Christian friend who talked to you about Jesus and tried to answer your questions. Most of them were silly, but your friend never gave up. Perhaps it was a Christian family member who was with you and stayed with you through very, very difficult times and deep times and dark times. Perhaps it was a Christian colleague who you respected so much because your Christian colleague, not your Christian, you weren't a Christian, but this Christian stood up in a boardroom and said, "We can't do that. It's illegal. It's corruption." That impressed you. You see, that's part of the chain. That's part of the providential chain of God. And here you are. Someone said, "Come to church." Someone said, "Read a book." And God rescued you. God saved you. Because they did their little bit in that providential change. So the challenge for us is this, that we are part of that chain. And God gives us opportunities. It may just be a word here. It may just be a phone call to say that you care. It may just be a small act. It may just be dropping hints. We don't know how God can use that to accomplish his purposes. And here's the catch. Do you know that these people in the chain won't know in this life that that person came to know Christ? Isn't that interesting? Probably only the last person in the chain, but the other people in the chain wouldn't know. They'd only find out in heaven. Last year, one of our speakers at our outreach week was Andres Tele. Now Andres is he's an ordained minister. He's a lecturer at Johannesburg Bible College. He's doing his PhD in mission. You remember his testimony. He told us that when he was brought up, his grandmother took him to Sunday school. He went to Sunday school. And then during his teenage years, he drifted from the faith until he had a crisis. And at the time of that crisis, he remembered what he was taught 15 years ago, 12 years ago, at Sunday school. And he came to faith in Christ. And now he teaches at a Bible college. But you know this. Those Sunday school teachers don't know that that little brat who was so difficult in the class is now not only a Christian, but he's teaching the Bible. They don't know it. They'll only find out in heaven. So it is with us. We say, Lord, use me today in little ways, in big ways. We don't know where it's going to end up. But God in his providence will use every step, every chain to accomplish his purposes. All right, thirdly, God's command, God's providence, God's method. Now, God's method in bringing someone to know Christ has never changed. There are three indispensable elements, all of which are in this passage, in bringing someone to know Christ, in God's mission. The first element is Scripture. So notice again verse 28. The eunuch was reading from the Bible, from the book of Isaiah. We pick that up, verse 28. And he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And verse 32 to 33 tells us exactly what he was reading. It's the Scriptures. It's the truth of the Scriptures that convict us, that strike us, that cut us to the heart. Why do you come here week by week on a perfectly good Sunday morning? Well, we come because we meet with God's people. That's a wonderful thing. That's a precious thing. We come because we sing and we praise God and thank God in song. When we sing, that's part of our prayers. Do you know that? It's part of our prayers when we sing. But one of the key reasons we come is to hear God's voice. And we hear God's voice when we read God's word. And it's the word of God. It's not me. It's the word of God. It's not the preacher. It's the word of God that convicts us, that comforts us, that cuts us to the heart. It's the word of God that deals with our guilt and our sin. It's the word of God that deals with our anxieties and fears. It's the word of God that deals with our self-image and our self-confidence. It's the word of God that answers the great questions of life. Who am I? Why am I here? What's the purpose of life? It's God's word that washes over us, convicting us and teaching us and encouraging us. The New Age says you must empty your mind. And for some of us, that's not very difficult. God says, no, don't empty your mind. Fill your mind with God's word. The New Age says, look within yourself. The power is within yourself. God says, no, the power is not within yourself. It's in me. It's in my word. God's method has always been God's, the Scriptures has always been God's method in changing us. Years ago, I was a lecturer at the Bible Institute in Cape Town, and one of our students there came from Lesotho. He came from up in the mountains in a very, very remote village where there was no church, no Bible, no Christians. And he was a genuine seeker after God. But he had no Bible. There was no church. One night he had a dream. He told us this in class. He had a dream. And in this dream, someone came to their village with a book. And that was the end of the dream. And then about 12 months later, a missionary came to their village with a book, with a Bible. That is God's method. The second part of God's method is his spirit. So notice the supernatural presence of the Holy Spirit throughout this passage, verse 29. And the Spirit said to Philip, go over and join this chariot. Verse 39. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip along, and the eunuch saw him no more. So without the Spirit, we will remain dead in our trespasses and sins. It's the Spirit of God that opens our eyes. It's the Spirit of God that does the miracle. It's the Spirit of God that takes away the hardness from our hearts. It's the Spirit of God who gives us spiritual life and converts us. So we have in our church, we have DNA, and we've been talking about that. But we also have a philosophy of ministry. Our philosophy of ministry is this, that we teach the word in the power of the Holy Spirit. So for people to be converted, for people to grow as Christians, for a church to be planted, for a church to grow to maturity, what do they need? They need the word of God in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's why every week when we gather around God's word. That's why the Bible tots, 18 months old, are learning God's word. Obviously, it's age appropriate, but it's the word of God that changes people's lives. That's why we have 120 teenagers in the multipurpose hall. They're not playing games. We take teenagers seriously. They have serious questions. So we teach them God's word. That's why Friday nights we have 150 kids at Kids Club. Sometimes pretty chaotic. But we teach them God's word because that's our philosophy of ministry. So when we come here week by week, we don't have a Christian rock concert. There's nothing wrong with a Christian rock concert. But it's not going to grow somebody. We don't have a multimedia experience. There's nothing wrong with that. But that's not the key to spiritual growth. The key to spiritual growth is God's word and God's spirit. That's the key. That's why we do what we do. Third thing, of course, is a human agent. So God uses human agents, and obviously it's Philip in this passage. He calls Philip. Philip takes the opportunity. He speaks up. He shares the gospel. So God uses human agents, people like you and me, fragile people, finite people, sinful people. He uses us in his sovereignty to grow his kingdom. And the gospel has to do with words. Perhaps you've heard someone say, I let my life do the talking. Well, of course that's true, and it should be true, that we should lead lives of integrity, not perfection, but lives of integrity, that our lips match, or our life matches our lips. But it's equally true that the Bible knows no such thing as a silent Christian. You may remember that quote by Francis of Assisi, who said, when you share the gospel, if necessary, use words. Do you remember that? Well, with respect, he's wrong. Of course, we must lead lives of integrity. But the gospel is words. The gospel is good news about Jesus, which need to be spoken. And we are the human agents. We are part of that chain so that someone comes to know Christ. Lastly, will you notice God's command, God's providence, God's method, and God's message. Turn with me to the passage that the Ethiopian eunuch was reading, Isaiah chapter 53. Let's just quickly have a look at that and how Philip then explained to the Ethiopian eunuch about Jesus. This is the clearest passage in the Old Testament concerning the substitutionary death of Christ on the cross. There's nothing clearer than this particular passage. Now, he was quoting from verse 7. He was reading from verse 7. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living? But no doubt he would have started with verse 3 to 6, which you remember is this clear explanation of the substitutionary death of Christ. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. Then notice, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. No wonder verse 35, Philip talks about Jesus. There's only one gospel. It's not something we discover. No, it's something that's been revealed. It's not about us trying to reach God through the Ten Commandments or trying to live a good life or being religious. No, there's only one gospel, and it's about Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. The result, let me close a second time. Verse 36. The man is converted. Two things happen. He's baptized. Baptism doesn't make you a Christian. The thief on the cross didn't have time to be baptized, but it is an outward sign of an inward work of God. So if you have recently come to know Christ, or perhaps some time ago, and you haven't been baptized, you need to be baptized. It's a public confession that you are making of a private work of God. And if your children haven't been baptized, they also need to be baptized because God very often deals with us as families. And then lastly, he goes away rejoicing, verse 39. Why? Because he's been reconciled with God. Why? Because his sins and guilt is forgiven. Why? Because he's been adopted into God's family. Why? Because he's been justified, declared righteous in the presence of God because of what Christ has done for him on the cross. That is our mission, to share that message through our lives, through our love, and especially through our words. And God in his providence will use us as part of a chain for others to come to know Christ. Let's pray.